Hello and welcome to the presentation of Group G16 for our course project CL246 Heat Transfer. Our project is called SOVAC, which stands for Solar Powered Refrigerator for Vaccine Storage. Now, the motivation for SOVAC comes from the fact that over the last 1 year, all of us have suffered the brunt of the pandemic, some more so than others. However, at the time of ideation of our project, one of the key questions that was being asked with respect to the pandemic was how India would handle its vaccination drive. Ramping up cold storage facilities was seen as the only way India could fight the virus. And yet, at the same time, there was news as follows, which showed that vaccine storage issues could leave more than 3 billion people in the world without access. Now, vaccine storage issues were not limited only to third world countries. For instance, Pfizer, a tech giant in USA, also faced problems storing the vaccine at sub-zero temperatures. This can be seen through the following graph. This is a prediction graph made by Goldman Sachs in the month of October 2020, which predicted the percentage of population various countries would have vaccinated over the course of 2021. However, we see that both USA and UK fall far behind the predicted values. And one of the reasons we attribute this is to the fact to the difficulty in storing vaccines in these sub-zero temperatures. Now, current cold storage methods are not only expensive, but also hazardous to the environment. For instance, this is the CO2 emission levels for storing various vaccines using the R404 refrigerant. So while the current storage units are expensive, non-renewable and hazardous to the environment, we see an alternative in SOVAC. SOVAC is built trying to keep it cheap, renewable and environment friendly. We also realize that there are several rural areas in India where vaccines need to be delivered, and thus portability has been kept in mind. So diving into how SOVAC works, so it works in two cycles, the day and night. We look at each one closely. So during the day, radiation from the sun is incident on the collector plate. It heats up the refrigerant, which vaporizes, goes to the condenser, and then it is turned back into a liquid refrigerant and stored eventually in the evaporator. Now, a common way to analyze these phase transitions is through the well-known Clapeyron diagram, which is a graph of log P versus 1 by T. So initially, the collector heats up and its pressure rises from the evaporator pressure to the condenser pressure. And then at constant temperature, desorption occurs and it vaporizes and goes into the condenser. Now during the night, as the collector returns back to surrounding temperature and cools down, the liquid refrigerant experiences a natural convection. In this process, it absorbs heat from the water bath, converting into ice. And inside which we plan to store our vaccine. So once again, looking at the Clapeyron diagram, it begins to cool. And then at constant pressure, which is at the evaporator pressure, it is absorbed back into the collector. Now, looking into some of the design considerations of SOVAC, the collector plate is supposed to be built of stainless steel. It's supposed to be airtight to retain the potency of the adsorbent. It is supposed to be painted black for maximum heat absorption. Similarly, the evaporator is supposed to have a polyurethane insulation, and these trapezoidal extensions are a key feature to facilitate heat transfer between the water bath and the evaporator. Now, the reasons for looking into these design considerations is this key aspect of any refrigeration cycle called the coefficient of performance, or the COP. Now, we choose a working pair of activated carbon and methanol and the above mentioned design considerations to get a COP of 0.12. Now, this COP simply refers to the ratio of the cooling effect, which is the amount of energy that will be used for production of ice, upon the net energy we supply to it in terms of solar radiation. So now, our next aspect will be to determine the amount of ice SOVAC can produce, since this will directly correlate to the duration for which we can store our vaccine. In this, we assume that SOVAC is working in the time frame 7 a.m. to 12 noon, which corresponds to the peak sunlight period. So now, to determine solar irradiation, we collected month-wise data and time-wise for the city of Nagpur. Now, these gave us discrete points, which were averaged and converted into a continuous graph by fitting a second degree polynomial, which was done through NumPy. Now, once we got the graph, the total amount of solar irradiation in this time frame is simply the area under the graph, which is calculated by this formula, which is known as Simpson's formula. Here, A and B are simply the limits of integration. So 0 corresponds to 7 a.m. B, which is 5, corresponds to 12 noon. We discretize these points, calculate the functional valued steps, and evaluate the integral using this formula. By inputting all the values, we got the net incident energy per unit area as following. So now the governing equation to calculate the amount of ice produced is as follows. This is the net energy required to convert water to ice, and the latent heat of fusion is also taken into consideration. The right hand side gives the incident energy multiplied by the coefficient of performance, which is the net useful energy, into the area, into the thermal absorptivity of the collector. Out of this, everything is known except the mass of ice. Thus, we divide the right hand side by this expression to get mass is 14.43 kgs. And the volume of icebox as about 15,000 centimeters.
Having completed our view of the collector, we now move on to the evaporator. The problem statement for the evaporator is as follows, that the adsorbent-adsorbent pair evaporates during the day to convert a water bath to an ice layer. The evaporator outer surface is maintained at 25 degrees Celsius by coating with light paint, whose reference is provided at the end of slides. The air temperature, ambient air, is at 30 degrees Celsius. The inner side of the evaporator is coated with a thin insulating layer of polyurethane, beyond which we have a thin air gap leading to the ice box. And our objective at the end of this section would be to calculate the maximum time for which the vaccines can remain potent if they have to be stored below 8 degrees Celsius. The assumption that we will be making for this is that there is a 5-hour sunlight exposure, which we have already used in calculation. There is negligible heat transfer from the top. The white paint alters only the surface temperature and nothing else. There is one-dimensional steady state conduction through the polyurethane layer, as well as the fact that the layer does not store any energy within itself. The two sides of the cavity, which we will elaborate a bit more about later on, are assumed to be infinite plates to ease the calculation. And the maximum rise in temperature we consider is still 6 degrees Celsius, where we allow 2 degrees Celsius to be a cushioning temperature or a threshold temperature. This is our control volume. This is the outer surface, which is air, followed by the polyurethane thickness, followed by the air gap, followed by the icebox. This icebox inside contains the vaccine box, which is designed in a manner so as to be able to store 500 doses of vaccines. We will now focus our attention on every part of the evaporator and calculate the necessary quantities that we require. The first is the outer surface of the evaporator, where air is in free convection. The film temperature is 300 Kelvin. Accordingly, the parameters of air are calculated. The corresponding non-dimensional number is the Rayleigh number, which is of the order 10 raised to 5, showing that air is in laminar flow. Accordingly, we calculate a Nusselt number correlation, the value of H bar, as well as the heat that is incoming to the evaporator. Next, we move our attention to the polyurethane coating, where the predominant mode of heat transfer will be conduction. We write an overall energy balance, and based on our assumptions that E dot stored is equal to E dot, we get our expression simplified. Then we write the basic expression for conduction, and we get the inner surface temperature to be 18.3 degrees Celsius. We note that any heat that is incoming now will not be able to change the inner surface temperature, but will now be used to melt the ice. Therefore, in the air gap, there are two major modes of heat transfer. The first is free convection, which is modeled as an enclosure. Accordingly, the parameters of air at room temperature are as follows. Once again, we calculate the Rayleigh number as well as the aspect ratio of the cavity. Based on these parameters, we are able to choose a suitable Nusselt number, the value of H bar, as well as the heat transfer rate. But we've already stated that there is radiation as well. Accordingly, we calculate the emissivities from literature, which are as follows, and the value of the heat transfer rate because of radiation. This Q double dash radiation plus Q double dash convection gives the total heat transfer that is happening through one phase, however, per unit area. However, we have assumed that there are four phases of the evaporator through which heat transfer can occur, and therefore the total incoming radius, total incoming heat rate is calculated as follows. Then, recognizing the fact that 14.43 kgs of ice were formed and the value of the latent heat of heat, we calculate the total time required for ice to melt, which is about 8 minutes. The graph that is plotted here gives the various values of the, gives the time to melt for various values of polyurethane thickness and air gap. Then we write the differential energy balance to calculate the time that it takes for the water bath temperature to rise from 0 to 6 degrees Celsius. Remember the 2 degree cushioning. We ignore the transient convection terms, and on integrating we obtain 0.24 hours, and therefore the total time for which the vaccines can remain open is about 8.84 hours. The following is the temperature profile for the entire evaporator assembly. This, as you can see, is the free convection, followed by conduction in the polyurethane foam, followed by convection as well as radiation in the air gap. This is an attempt at cost estimation. These are the various components of SOVAX, and the prices are listed as the standardized prices in the Indian markets. Accordingly, we get that the total price for constructing a SOVAC unit would be about 32,000, which is a 30 to 40% reduction in cost from commercially available our ice makers. And therefore, our goal that we'd initially stated, that we would like to make SOVAC cheaper, is accomplished, along with reduction in emissions as well. There are obviously a lot of improvements that can be made. Accordingly, literature suggests two major improvements. One is heat recovery by adsorption refrigeration system. The other is a hybrid continuous adsorption refrigeration system. And there are a couple of others like heat recovery, mass recovery, multi-stage and multi-bed recovery. All these are beyond the scope of this project, and we will not be going into detail in this. The interested people are deferred to appropriate research. In conclusion, we would like to state that the assembly that we generated and thought for SOVAC was able to keep vaccine for a reasonable period of time. Based on the design, however, it looks as if initially SOVAC would be used as makeshift installation only, where you can store vaccines probably for an overnight thing, beyond which they can be retransported back. Full portability, however, is the goal. We use renewable sources of energy. The reduction of emission, however, would be determined only by actual application. And this was our honest attempt at contributing towards the drive of full vaccination. We hope that India as well as the entire world gets out of this pandemic soon, and we are able to restore some sense of normalcy in our lives. We hope that you enjoyed the video and were able to learn something from it. Thank you so much.